In the early 90s, the landscape of music went through a renaissance we never saw coming. The days of glam gave way to the grittier sound of groove, industrial, and urban sounds found on the streets of New York that pioneered change throughout rock and metal forever. Today, I have the honor and privilege to be joined by some of these pioneers and members of White Zombie on their 30th anniversary of the worldwide acclaimed La Sexorcisto. Jay Younger, Shawnee Salt, and Ivan DuPreme.
Thanks.
Thank you.
First of all, this is simply amazing to be looking at you guys. You know, when was the last time you three saw each other?
Well, I saw Sean a couple of weeks ago, but I haven't laid eyes on you since like the 90s probably, right?
Yeah. It's been, I think you came back to my studio in North Hollywood. We were hanging out.
I mean, it's you live in California, right?
Well, right now I live in Oregon, but I saw you was in L.A. Mm-hmm.
It's just because I left the West Coast. I probably would have seen you at some point, but I haven't been back there very much.
I was going to say, me and Ivan saw each other in New York City. We got some Indian food.
Oh, that was fun. That was cool. That was cool.
Like I said, I mean, it's just an amazing sight to see, you know, the three of you in the same room together. taking us back in time, really, you know, think back, you know, it's the 90s, the early 90s. Things are a lot different in the world than they are today. You had, you know, at the time, a couple albums under your belt. Metal itself was going through a big shift. New York was a completely different place than it is today. How did White Zombie at the time fit into the scene, you know, of what you guys were doing?
We didn't really. Right?
Well, you have a really interesting thing that happened where White Zombie was like part of the Lower East Side, like CBGB's kind of like very grimy noise scene, sort of. It wasn't really a scene, really, as you've said to me. It wasn't really like everybody was buddies or anything, but like it wasn't a metal scene or anything. And then after I joined the band, in another year, we were playing in straight up metal, suburban metal clubs with like the Cro-Mags. Like it was completely insane. Think about it, how quickly things changed when you know, like I joined the band and then we decided like we are going to be a metal band and we're going to pursue being in that world. And then we pulled it off, which is, it's still kind of amazing to me that we were like, you know, yeah, like playing with like Biohazard in, you know, in far Brooklyn.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
That's pretty cool. That's pretty crazy.
Yeah. That was Ivan's stomping ground, right?
Yeah. That was an epic moment when Jay joined the band with his sound and we went metal. We were just like, you know, I think it was when Rob wanted to hear some more Metallica on tour and and I was like, yep, I'll throw it in the CD player. Then,
well, and you know, to that, I have to add the fact that when we finished the record and we went to the record company, and we'll get to this, how they just didn't know what to make of us. you know, most of the company was like, who the fuck is this? Who are these jerks from New York? What is this shit? But then the people who were part of the metal promotions department were like, no, this is great. Can we work on this? We'll work on this. And we were like, oh, the metal people are our friends and everybody else hates us. Okay, we'll be metal.
Yeah, it made more sense. We were always like a really heavy band, but it didn't fit in with the other bands in the Lower East Side in East Village. You know, they just kind of scratched their heads and stared at us.
Yeah, we didn't really fit in with anybody.
You guys were crazy.
I remember the night it happened, actually, because Rob and I were wheat pasting at 2 a.m. We were on St. Mark's at Third Avenue.
Does your audience understand the concept of wheat pasting? Probably not.
Probably not. It's back how you used to
just
get the word
say
out.
putting up flyers in the street in the freezing cold.
Plastering the flyers.
For another show at CBGB's that a lot of people are going to be standing there like this, arms crossed, looking at us like bored, shitless, you know. We didn't make any sense to them and we're flyering. And all of a sudden we see Harley from the Cro-Mags walking towards us. And our immediate instinct is like, oh shit, he's gonna come kick our ass. Because that's what the Cro-Mags and skinheads did. And he came over and he said, man, I really like what you guys are doing. You wanna come out and play a gig with us at L'Amour's? And we were like, yes, don't kill us. And that was the first one. And then I don't know, Ivan, if it was through you or those guys were there, are you old friends of Biohazard? But Biohazard kept having us out at Lemoore's, and
yeah,
everybody was nice to us, and they, you know, ran around and got in mosh pits and had fun. And I was like, this is so much better.
And then we played with Slayer a couple of times, yeah. And the audience really liked us, and we sold shirts, and that was, I mean, I don't know what we were expecting. I think it was just one of those situations where you put your head down and you just go do it.
I'm always expecting an ass kicking.
I mean, that's like that at that time, that was the toughest. I mean, famously in the metal world, that was like the toughest crowd there was in the early 90s was a Slayer crowd. And I remember distinctly, you know, Slayer also, you know, are famously like not like cuddly friendly guys.
Oh.
And I remember when we were about to go on and the whole crowd was going, Slayer, Slayer. And they were all standing there because they knew this was going to happen. They were kind of mocking us. They were like, they're calling your name. Better get on stage.
Yeah. Hanneman but then was right in my ear saying that.
They're
yeah.
real dicks about it. Then we went on stage and the crowd liked us.
Yeah.
And so that just kind of pulled us into that world even more, you know.
It always seemed like you guys were at that crossroad of finding your footing. It's like somewhere between metal, avant-garde, art world, alternative world, you know.
Well, and also at that point, things were really rigidly delineated, you know what I mean? It's like you were either metal or you were like punk or you were like this, or you were like a weirdo, like, you know, band like the Butthole Surfers or something that could play punk shows but, you know, couldn't play metal shows or whatever. And then, you know, after this time when we recorded this record, then Lollapalooza happened. And I think that was a huge, huge part of all those walls breaking down. But when we put the record out, it was still like, we're either going to channel you into this or we're going to channel you into that. And yeah, we were all artsy kids. Yeah. You know, Shauna and I had both been in the hardcore scene in the early 80s. You know, Ivan was like total metal kid. You know, we were coming from a bunch of different places, and nobody really understood that yet. Whereas now that's like old hat, you know?
Yeah. I was going to say also, we weren't the only band that was kind of like weird, arty underground meets metal, because we got to tour a little with Voivod and also Die Kreuzen. We play a lot with Die Kreuzen when we went out to the Midwest, and those bands kind of had that a little bit of noise mixed with metal.
Yeah, I remember when De Kreutzen got hair and started playing metal shows. That was interesting.
Yeah.
Oh, I bet Ivan was happier than ever to play metal then.
Oh, man. You have no idea. Because the band started off with a different sound. And that sound, I mean, it was cool. I was digging it. We were playing all kinds of heavy stuff. I mean, Sean and I still played the heavy rhythms. But when, you know, we went through many guitar players. Jay was our fifth guitar player. And we finally landed on the sound that metal sound that was like, oh, I was that.
And we also tricked him. We told him there was going to be another guitarist, remember?
Well, I mean,
we took him to the photo shoot before we even had him in the band, right?
I really wanted to do it, but I was not confident that I could be a lead guitar player in a band. And the whole, I mean, until we were like really in the thick of touring for Los Sexorcisto, which was like, I think we were out for like 2.5 years or something, until we were really in that, I was playing at the edge of my ability all the time. You know what I mean? I was always like kind of white knuckling it. Like, am I good enough to be in this band? So, you know, yeah, you had to trick me. It never would have happened. I did not have the confidence.
Yeah.
But then when you roped me into it, I was like, okay, I have to rise to this occasion. And it was like one of the first times in my life I ever did that, you know. I'm like, well, they're counting on me. I have to do this. I can't not do it. You know, so that was actually very good for me that you guys tricked me.
Jay, I mean, you came on board and there was this, like, I could see the transition because we were living together in that house, and I just watched you like just from where you were to, you know, getting the long dreadlocks and getting the headbanging thing down. I mean, I remember you had this, I think you had the strobe lights and smoke machine on in the studio in the basement, and you were just headbanging, just working out the riffs, and I was like, wow. And then we had our look, we all shaped our sound and our visual appearances, and it's like I was just so happy, you know, to see how it all just came together. You worked hard to get that, and
well, I mean, I didn't have any money. I was practically homeless, so all I did all day was play, because yeah. I certainly wasn't eating much.
That was a crazy thing. We were all like really broke, you know. Yeah. Like I was living on $3 a day. I got paid $100 a week. Minimum wage was $3 an hour. And then when they took the taxes out, someone got $100.
A long check. Time ago.
So yeah, you could kind of eat for $3 a day, but it was rough.
I grew up in New York, and you know, at the same time in the 80s and 90s, and it definitely brings back. You know, I always think of you guys as a New York band, and like really, you know, hometown heroes, if anything, you know.
Yeah.
But yeah, I did want to talk about a little bit. You know, how did Jay actually come into the fold? What was that? Because I believe that you auditioned for the band, right?
I mean, yes, but nobody else did.
We just kind of met in Union Square Park. We're like, yeah, come try it out.
Yeah, I mean, they called me. It was really, really, really by chance. I had moved to New York, tried to form bands, you know, like really failed, like ran out of money very quickly. The guy who I had moved in with was working at Forbidden Planet. You guys were in there. I mean, this is a story I've always heard. It's like, you know, he said, "Hey, how's it going, White Zombie guys?" And you were like, "Oh, really bad. We don't have a guitar player." And he said, "Oh, well, I have the number of this one guy." And that's how it happened.
Yeah.
But then, you know, it was as simple as that, except, you know, the trick of it was, though, that you were like one of the first bands I had seen when I moved to New York. And I was like really fascinated by your image, but also just the weirdness of it.
Yeah.
You know, there are so many aspects to it that I was like everything I wanted to know about at that time, you know, like long hair, they're like heavy metal, but they're not like heavy metal. They're like smart, but crazy. Flames everywhere, flames, you know. So when you called me up, I knew, you know, I knew right away like what that was. And I was like, oh man, I want to do that. So yeah, we met. Guess you didn't hate me on site. But then what happened after that was like Michael Levine, right? The photographer.
Yeah.
He wanted to like test some new lights or something. And he wanted to do a session with you guys. And you were like, "Oh, well, we need a fourth member. So come along." And so I was doing a photo session with you before I ever played a note.
Wow.
Which was very strange. That was really weird.
Was it one of our record covers?
No, he was just, he like shot, we didn't ever use any of those pictures.
Oh, okay.
He just shot, he just did a session.
Okay.
And you brought me along to be the guitar player in the photo session on his roof.
Wow. I don't remember that.
You know, you don't remember that?
Michael Levine was an old friend of mine. I went to Parsons and I was a photography major and design major. And I kind of spent a lot of time in the photo department working, you know, jobs in the dark room to make a little extra money. So I met Michael Levine there, and he worked for Scovolo. I think he was just an incredible photographer. So we were lucky, got a lot of nice record covers from him.
He did some very cool record covers for you guys. I mean, my other big story about moving to New York is the day I moved to New York, one of the first things I did was I went to the CBGB record canteen and I saw your Soul Crusher record from across the room. And I was like, "That, what is that?" It was like a beacon, you know, which is funny how things ended up going, because I did, that record really stood out, and I ran and I grabbed it and I bought it. And then when I put it on, I was like, "What the hell is this?" Because it was not remotely like what I was expecting, but not like anything I had heard either.
Yeah.
You know, really, really a crazy sound. But yeah, and then I don't know, like then you got sick. So then I had a couple weeks extra to practice. And then we played together. And when we played together, you never said anything. You were just like, "Okay, the next practice is in 2 days." I was like, "Okay." You know, and that was that. You know, I don't think you had ever met somebody who was as into it. And that's what got me across.
Yeah.
You know? it wasn't my incredible playing ability. It was like, I was like, I'll do whatever you want. Just tell me. You want me to cut my legs off? I'll do it to be in this band, you know? No, seriously, that's how I felt.
Well, honestly,
and you guys were like, oh, that's cool. Okay.
Yeah.
We'll let you hang around with us. You know, I think it's pretty much
it. We never like auditioned people, you know? It was like, we were so insular and didn't really know.
You were very subtle too.
Yeah, it's like,
you never said anything. You were like, okay, come to practice in 2 days.
It's so weird. Sorry. Anyway, we were very insular and just, you know, we'd see somebody like Tom, who was a guitar player before Jay, he went to
Parsons. Number three.
Yeah, he went to Parsons. So we met him there and you know, Robin and I met at Parsons. He was there and then dropped out the next year. I think I'm the only one that graduated somehow. It's weird with the schedule that we had, but yeah, it was with you. You were recommended by good friends, and we just met you and thought, hey, seems cool.
Yeah,
we just kind of rolled with it, you know. And
well, and then we immediately started trying. So you have the Make Them Die Slowly record, which is a strange record. Like, the music is, but the production is extremely strange.
Yeah.
And you had a lot of trouble making that record. And so immediately the idea was like, let's take that and like kind of fix that. So that's where we started from, I think.
Yeah.
Disaster Blaster 2.
Yeah, right. You know. And you know, I just listened to Los Sexorcisto, and there are elements of, you know, slight elements of Make Them Die Slowly on that record. You know, things that kind of ideas from that time that kind of came through a little bit.
Yeah, I think as a fan, I listened to it and you can hear the trajectory going from the first to second to third, you know, but Los Sexorcisto really is considered to the greater metal world as the rebirth of White Zombie in a lot of ways, you know, with a different vibe, look, message, sound, aesthetic. Was there, you know, a discussion, like a deliberate shift or discussion within the band to kind of start over and try something new?
Yes, we went to a Slayer concert and it was like, that's what we want to do, boom, and we did it like that. It was just, I think it was pretty much that, and then we went to Metallica, you know. We were just all about embracing that whole element, you know.
Well, and trying to do something that we would want to see as fans, I think, was the biggest part of it, you know. It's like, let's look like a band that we'd want to see. Let's sound like a band we'd want to see, like, you know. Those were conscious things. I do remember that.
Yeah,
you know, and we were like an insular little gang, you know. It's like, okay, we're all gonna wear high tops now because we're metal. We're gonna wear black high tops. Everybody had to have black high tops. You know
even when we first started, like our first show at CBGB's, we were always trying to put on like a big like kind of rock show. Like, you know, if we saved any money up, we'd get like some flashing lights down on Canal Street and put them on our amps, you know. And, you know, we loved Kiss, we loved AC/DC, we liked a lot of hard rock. We just, you know, didn't, you know, we were totally always going to the hardcore matinees. And some of those are like, I think all of us were huge Void fans, and Void were kind of a big weird crossover of like metal and hardcore. So, you know, we liked all this, but we were always trying to put on the show, you know, that was gonna be that kind of show. So it wasn't, you know, when we got bigger and it is that kind of a metal rock show, it's like we were always trying to do that. We just didn't have the money to do it very well.
And we also really into NWA and, you know, Public Enemy, that edgy.
Well, that was that time where, I mean, you know, throughout the middle 80s, like one night I would go see Metallica, and then, you know, 2 days later I'd go see like Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds, you know, and that was how you guys were as well. You know, you liked everything that was cool. And then, you know, into the 90s, you have the golden era of hip hop where, you know, like rap music was really exciting. And most people who were really into heavy music who had taste were listening to Public Enemy at that point. You know, we certainly were. And you can hear it in some things that we did.
Yeah.
You know, by the time we recorded Los Sexorcisto, that had creeped in.
Yeah, the record we kind of made in between the God of Thunder EP, three songs. We recorded that at Chung King Studios, and Run DMC were in and out of their recording while we were there.
It's so great.
We're so excited. I got their autographs.
Like I moved to New York City and now I'm in a studio with Run DMC. Like, this is really great.
Yeah, that was exciting. That was a fun record we did with Daniel Ray, who's the fifth Ramone. Yeah, good times. So yeah, all that was going on, you know, and we liked all that. It wasn't totally like, we just want to be an underground band. We always kind of, we're trying to be a big band.
Yeah, I think that certainly comes through, you know, in the record for sure. It has elements from everywhere. It's you know, a psychedelic circus, you know, as everyone really knows it to be. A couple things. You did mention working with a photographer, a longtime photographer. And, you know, I think it's also not only aesthetically and sonically changing on this record, but like you can notice, you know, the colors and everything incorporated, like this kind of new facet of White Zombie where you incorporated art and colors and a new aesthetic and stuff like that. Was that an art direction from you guys or from your photographer or outside influences?
Okay, that happened through a series of errors and accidents. And we spent all this time building this crazy set out of bones.
Oh, Christ, right.
Yeah, so my parents lived in Santa Fe, and outside of Santa Fe, there was this place called Big Pile of Bones. And we just loved it. Every time we go, we like buy as many bones as we could. There's huge bones and skeleton, you know, whatever, backbones, everything, rib bones. And we built this crazy set out in the middle of nowhere that was kind of like a throne Rob wanted to sit in and all this stuff. It was insane. And so we're going to be out there. Our photographer, I don't want to say his name because he's a famous photographer and it was a huge fuck up, but our photographer at the time didn't have his lamps like programmed to flash. I don't know, the flashes weren't going off. And so all the photos were blurry and it cost a ton of money. So after that, we had no money left over. And we were kind of friends with a girl, Allison Dyer, and she offered to do some snapshots of us. And yeah, that whole collage came painfully together in one of the Geffen offices in the art department. Rob and I stood
up. We went on her roof and did it in like 20 minutes, right?
Yeah, but we were in the art department like for like months, like over this guy's shoulders. You're like, no, make that this color, do this, move it around.
Well, and you should mention that this is so long ago that it took like Photoshop like 10 minutes to render a change.
Oh yeah, it was really weird. Yeah, when I did the White Zombie circular logo, Rob did the artwork in the middle, but like when I was just trying to create that White Zombie ring, it took hours. I went to my boss's house and like she just got a new computer, you know. Yeah, all that stuff was so hard back then. But yeah, so no, that was just kind of a weird series of, you know, accidents that kind of led to that cover.
And it's hard to imagine that original idea, you know, happening, because it's so clearly now not the right cover.
Right. It wouldn't have been psychedelic at all. It would have just been a little, you know.
There are so many crazy things that could have only happened one way, and that was one of them.
Yeah. I mean,
I never thought about that before.
Yeah, I like how it turned out, but it wasn't intentional.
Yeah, I forgot about that previous photo.
Forgot about that.
Yeah, now you bring it up. That throne was insane. I remember like, oh my, this is crazy. Yeah. It was a very demented scene we created there. And
we were like carrying lumber around and like doing carpentry and
it took a long time.
Yeah.
Was that like a huge indoor shack or was it outdoors that the throne was sitting in?
I don't remember.
It seemed like it was kind of indoors, but maybe open air.
Yeah, it was all scratch. It was like in a barn, I think.
Yeah.
It was a perfect,
like in the middle of nowhere.
Perfect
in,
scene for
like Central
movie.
California.
Yeah. The
perfect location for a horror movie. Christ. I got to tell you, that was like.
Yeah.
Christ almighty. I totally forgot about that.
So yeah, that cover took a while to come about with.
Making lemonade, really, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I want to. Sure. I did want to talk about the songwriting process. You know, so where did you start? Because I know that they're obviously with Jay in the fold now, and you guys wanting to be more metal and adopt different flavors of everything that you were into. where did it start? Like, what was the first track? You know, where did the riff start for the album?
I don't remember what the first song was. Do you?
I don't, but I'll tell you what. There's a demo, which most people I don't think have ever heard this, because it was like the demo that got assigned. You know how they used to do like a demo deal where a label would give you a little money.
Yeah.
And I just listened to it for the first time in a really long time, and it's very interesting because like Thunderkiss is exactly the same. It's like, it's a little bit slower, and there's like one tiny little part that we play differently, but it's like basically the same song. And even like I thought that, like, you know, because I solo over the chorus, and I had thought that that was like a thing that we did with Andy Wallace, but no, we had that way previous to that. And then Soul Crusher is on there, and that is, there are some parts that are a little different. And then I Am Legend is on there, and that's more different. It's going to be fun if people get to hear this stuff, if we ever put it out.
That'd be fun.
Then there's another song that was never released, and that I think we kind of pulled apart for riffs, and then the riffs kind of mutated. I mean, what I remember for the most part is that we attacked it like a lot of metal bands attack it, where there's just like tapes and tapes and tapes of riffs. Everybody makes their own tapes of riffs and brings them in. Everybody has ideas. Then you kind of start gluing things together and seeing what works. And then by the end of the day, everybody forgot what the original riff was, and whatever you came up with is like the thing that it is. And hopefully, you know, because we weren't typically, you know, nowadays everybody records everything. At that point, it had to be good enough so you could remember it, you know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, the process was not that different from like what a lot of metal bands would do then and now. But it was really, really difficult because Rob didn't sing, refused to do it, wouldn't try out ideas. We never knew what he was going to sing unless we went on stage or he had done vocals in the studio. He just wouldn't. He would just sit there and read the paper.
Yeah.
And like occasionally like look over the paper and go, that's pretty good.
And he would have a boombox.
I'd be
like, nope. Okay. Yeah.
And we had that boombox, like, through the boombox.
It was
box
that sucks, or that doesn't suck.
Yeah.
I mean, it was when we went, we did pre-production with Andy Wallace, which is another thing that there used to be a budget for, is like, you know, you'd go into a rehearsal space with the producer and they would kind of help you massage your songs into maybe something slightly better. And it's just funny to me listening to this demo, because I had thought that Andy Wallace had kind of like really changed a lot of things, but these songs that are like famous songs now are almost exactly the same. So we'd already had all that stuff, but
he did help a lot, though. I remember like there was some transitions that,
yeah,
and then some key changes, I think, that he suggested.
Couple
that
little,
we did
in- yeah, a couple little things.
I remember like he put in like some stops, you know, like
and there were a lot of like kind of orphan riffs that weren't part of anything that he helped us like put together into songs.
Oh, yeah.
Like, for example, you know, like Spider Baby is a good example of those were all orphan riffs that we put together to great effect. Like, that's a cool song.
Yeah.
You know, it's very creepy the way it came together. It sounds like it's one thing, but it's actually just kind of like, we got this. Do they work together? Yes. Okay,
yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
You know, the only song I specifically remember everything about writing, and I can tell you a lot about it, is Thunderkiss, because that was so different from everything else we had ever done up until that point.
I remember that.
I can
also
tell you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can tell you exactly how it happened, which is like, I was at your apartment on the Lower East Side, and we were like staying up all night drinking coffee and like, you know, writing riffs, and I came up with the dun dun dun, and then Rob was like, well, it needs a turnaround, can you do like a neener neener, you know? So there was that, and so we had that, we took that into the practice space. And so you'll remember Greg Skorka, our roadie, who lived down there in Ivan's basement in the back, and really primitively, it was like he was living in a cave. And we started playing that, you know, that riff with the turnaround over and over. And he busted through the door. He came running in and he was like, guys, that, whatever that is, do that.
Yeah.
That's it. That's the future. And we were like, oh, okay, good. Great. And then we were like stuck for a chorus for a couple of days.
And you and I would do these jams. And I remember, I was like, that's kind of Hendrix-y. I really like that.
Yeah.
Bam, bam, da, 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 da.
Yeah. So I brought that. I was like, well, guys, I don't know. I mean, I have this kind of thing that's kind of like real rock, loosey-goosey kind of thing.
Yeah.
But let's see if it works. And then it, and they liked it, which I thought they wouldn't. So then we did that. And then Shauna came up with the transition. I think the main riff for the middle is me. Yeah. And then the outro, I think, was you. And, yeah, you know, I remember everything about that one, but most of those songs I don't remember writing.
We would just piece things together. I mean, it's like...
Well, Black Sunshine is...
Oh, sorry?
Like Thunderkiss has a lot of me in it. Black Sunshine has a lot of you in it. Black Sunshine is very you.
That's, I did like, write those riffs, but it's like as a bass player, you're not...
Who the fuck else would write a riff in sixes? Like, what is wrong with you?
Well, it's crazy because it's 6/8 time, and I studied music since I was about 4 years old, so I was actually like performing, and this is weird, but I was like jamming with old blues guys at 8 years old and smoking nightclubs in Raleigh, North Carolina. So like I knew about like all these time signatures and all this stuff. I just had never played a bass before, but you know, I played violin, so I was like four strings, I'll figure it out. And anyway, I was like playing this riff and it's in 6/8 time, you know, and I didn't really know how to explain that to Ivan. We're the, you know, it's like the bass and the drums that gotta lock in, and he's playing like 4/4 beat and he just keeps playing it, and well, you know, eventually it matches up.
Yeah. Well, because it does go straight.
You do that at the end.
After every three. Yeah.
Yeah, after every three.
Has to turn around somewhere here.
It makes it
It resolves itself if you do it like that.
It makes it more complicated, but it
sounds more normal. Yeah. Actually.
Yeah.
You know, when you play through like that.
Yeah, and like I shouldn't be like writing in like, you know, 6/8 or 3/4 time anyway. It's like waltz time, you know, you'll be the metal band. But anyway, it was in like 6/8 time, and Ivan made it sound heavier with that crazy just pushing through a 4/4 and
Black Sunshine, it features Iggy Pop, and I always wondered actually, what was the story there? How did an emerging, young, broke New York City band get the attention of the godfather of punk, you know?
That was Michael Alago. Our A&R guy that signed us, he knew Iggy, and he came up with that idea. He's like, Rob, write something for Iggy to do here. I think he'll do it. And then he did. And then he came to our apartment, hung out for a little while with his girlfriend. That was amazing. Like, yeah, just to get to know him. Such a great guy.
One of the, maybe the coolest rock star I've ever met.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, great. You know, he of course, he did it in one take, you know, because he's got that voice.
He did a whole bunch, remember? They were all great. But yeah, the first one was great.
We used the first one, though, didn't we?
I think so.
And then he hung out for hours just telling us stories. It was great. Yeah. Man.
I did want to backtrack here for a second. You know, not to leave out all the other amazing tracks on the album that I love, but Thunderkiss 65 is one of those songs that continues to go down in history and achieve something I personally feel most songs don't or never will, and it's uniqueness. You know, I can utter the words Thunderkiss 65 and every metal head, you know, in the world knows the riff, they know the beat, they know the sound of it. Was it considered a single at first, or was it kind of just another song and then it became, you know, something after the fact?
It was the first single. It just didn't get any traction at first.
I think, as far as I can remember, we always considered that like the special one.
Yeah.
You know? I think it was our idea always that would be a single if we got that far, you know.
And once again, I don't know how, we're just always the bottom of the totem pole when it comes to money or anything happening, but Geffen didn't want to give us any money for a video. We finally got $15,000 out of them, which was just enough really for people to buy the film and make it. So we found somebody to make the video that would do it for free. We got our friends to jump in and we made that Thunderkiss video. And
well,
it got a
you should set
of,
that up though.
Huh?
You should set that up with like the very strange situation we were in New York where, you know, Alago signed us.
Yeah.
And Alago, of course, is famous for having the foresight and vision to sign Metallica. to Elektra. And so he's superstar A&R guy, which is a thing back then. Basically, you know, Geffen was a Los Angeles company, a West Coast company. There was a tiny office in New York City, and it was a Lago. And so he was just getting the power, because there's so much money at this time. You know, there was all that like Guns N' Roses money pouring in. He was given the power to basically do whatever he wanted. So he would just like sign bands and make records. And he signed us, and we recorded this record. He came by a couple of times, but we had never met anybody else from the record label except for him.
Yeah.
And so then we kind of had watched people we knew in New York get major label record deals, put out the record, go on tour for 6 months, blow all their money on like flight cases and, you know, eating out, and then being back at their day jobs, like within a year, you know. And we didn't want that to happen to us. And so, and this, I never would have had the foresight for this, but Shauna was like, we got to go to LA. We got to, you know, like be there when they are talking about putting out this record. We're used to being a little underground independent band. We can't just like ship something to the other side of the country and expect them to control it. That's not going to be good. And she was exactly right. We got out there, and as I said earlier, they were like, who are these jerks? What is this? They didn't even know. They were just like, what is this? Yeah. What do you expect us to do with this? That crazy Ilago has done it again.
Yeah. And we just got in their face every day.
So what she's getting at, talking about the video, is that we were like, listen, we're used to being poor. We're used to being hungry. Don't give us any money. All these other asshole bands that you're signing for millions of dollars who like clearly will never do anything. Don't give us all the money you're giving them. Don't do anything. Just promise you'll put the record out. And of course, at this time, not doing a video would have been suicide for any major label act of any kind. And so we're like, just let us make a video. We'll like try to pay for it ourselves. We'll get our friends to be in it. Just let us make one video. Let us go on tour in a van. That's all we ask. I mean, is that pretty much accurate, would you say?
Well, we didn't tell them not give us any money.
But you know what I mean.
Money. But they gave us a little money, yeah, and we got by. They gave us.
And by a little, she means a little.
It was $5,000 for all four of us, and we lasted like in LA. I was like, if we stay here in New York, we're going to divvy this up. We're going to be broke in a month or two. If we go to LA, we can all get into a, you know, there's apartments that were cheap. We didn't know those bad neighborhoods. They look nice to us because there's palm trees and things, but anyway, I was like, we go there, we can share a big apartment, it'll be, you know, at least last us 5 months, and we'll see where we're at, you know. And yeah, so we just did it. We packed up Ivan's van and drove across the country.
The van was all souped up by then. I rebuilt the engine with the hot rod parts from. Yeah, it was a crazy time.
what kind of mileage were you getting at this point?
Oh God. but basically we needed more power. When we would almost die out going up the hill with all our gear and all of us. And so I told the guy who lived upstairs in my building, and he was like, "You want some more power? Check this out." Next thing I know, I'm rebuilding the engine. I put in a 4-barrel carburetor, ski camshaft, and dual point distributor. That thing was insane, and I don't want to take up too much of our time talking about it, but it was awesome. When it was done, it flew to LA. Like we were, it was smooth. The ride was nice.
It was like a Big Daddy Roth
band. Exactly. Yeah. Cherry bomb mufflers, boom. And my neighbors hated me for the noise we created trying to get that thing going. But when we first started up, it's like, the whole neighborhood, like, it was loud.
Andy Wallace, obviously a big name, you know, important to Slayer, Nirvana. I mean, he's done so many amazing records. Was it a choice of yours, or was it a Michael decision, or what was the connection there to working with him?
We liked the Slayer records. We thought they sounded great. And so we were like, oh, we can get a producer, like a name producer. Okay, we want him. It's interesting. The very next thing he did after Los Sexorcisto was he went and mixed Nevermind. And that's when he got really famous. Oh, I mean, he was famous, but like, wow. that right after that is when he like really got famous. He would have been a lot more expensive had we gotten him after that.
So maybe it would have never happened if it was the other way around then, you know?
Could be, yeah.
Now,
let's Sexorcisto, I mean, really put you guys on the map of a new generation, you know, that emerged, the MTV generation, really. You know,
right.
It was impossible for me to turn on the television at the time without being sucked into watching you guys every single day. Can you talk about your relationship with the station and how did that begin?
Ricky Rockman had a lot to do with it, really. I mean, as far as us getting a relationship with them, he would have us on what was the show? The
Headbangers Ball.
Headbangers Ball. And he would just always, you know, support us and play our video and, you know, have us come on and get interviewed. And there's just any opportunity seemed to have, he'd try to give us a little help. And that was definitely, you know, got us in.
And wasn't he throwing these big parties in LA that we would play on New Year's Eve or, that was Del Gloria, but I also Ricky Rockman.
No, we played Ricky Rockman's birthday.
Yeah, he had a birthday bash, I think.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Well, the thing that seems crazy now and seems like science fiction to younger people is the incredible power and reach that MTV had. I mean, in my memory, you know, starting in the mid 80s, everybody, no matter who they were, every like young person, no matter who they were, had MTV on all the time. And so you had this really weird situation back then where, you know, your favorite band may have been Megadeth, but you still had MTV on during the day, all day. So you knew exactly what, you know, I don't know, like LaToya Jackson was up to or whatever, Paula Abdul, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's something that has changed entirely. It will never be repeated again, you know? MTV was all powerful. You were not going to do anything unless you had a video, at least on Headbangers Ball. I mean, you know, until this, you know, famous thing that people like to rib us about is Beavis and Butthead. But I mean, really, like, there was no other way that a band like us was going to be on MTV during the day. And so, you know, the crux of the thing is, like, all of a sudden, literally millions of people saw us on MTV who had never had seen us before, never would see us. And so that's, you know, our relationship with MTV in a nutshell right there.
I mean, it sounds like it was pivotal to your careers then.
Absolutely pivotal.
That was huge.
I mean, we were done. We had toured for a year and a half. We were done. We were writing a new album. And then this Beavis and Butthead thing happened and our record started shooting back up the charts. And they're like, guys, you got to go back out on tour. And we're like, oh, okay. And we toured for another year on that. And that's when we got really big.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. No, I mean, between Ricky Rockman and
Beavis and Butthead. Yeah.
I would like to add too, a little known fact is that we were the first band to be on Headbangers Ball and 120 Minutes.
Oh.
That had never been bridged before.
Yeah,
it's true.
Yeah.
No group had ever done both before because they were too separate.
Yeah, and I think that just speaks to the accessibility of what you guys were doing in both worlds, in all worlds. As an outsider, you know, watching you guys during an influential and pivotal time in my life, it seemed like a never-ending snowball of being busy for you, you know, playing every tour, every fest, TV spot, radio spot, and it created this massive sensation that can only be described as White Zombie. You know, reflecting on 30 years of this album, is there anything that you guys would have changed in that time?
It didn't really take its toll until, you know, the tour for Astro Creep. But, you know, we really worked way too hard. We did whatever they asked us to do. You know, we were just like, we were so kind of, you know, thrilled that we had tried to do this very difficult thing and it actually worked. And so we were just like, you know, whatever they say yes. You know, it was like that. And we really burnt ourselves out. Like, if I could take back anything, I would take back a little bit of that time. You know,
yeah.
I mean, we were young, we could handle it, but we did burn ourselves out, you know?
Yeah.
And ultimately the relationship with the band members burnt out as well, you know? I would take that back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
You know. That would be nice.
Yeah, and on that note, you know, I've never been fortunate to see Ivan play with White Zombie. I think I was about like 13 when you left the band, but I never really got the story of the departure. You know, Ivan, looking back, what was your reasons?
The big thing is the deterioration of my relationship with Rob. We just stopped talking, and our communication skills were just so bad with each other. And you know, like looking back, you know, I feel like under the circumstances, I don't know what else I could have done. But you know, I know that there's, you know, as a human being, I could have probably have had a little bit more compassion, maybe just really, you know, being there more for the band, you know, like with our communication and stuff. Like I feel like that time I just was so pissed off at him that I just shut myself out. And that was on tour. So like when I close myself off from him, I feel like I closed myself off from the whole band. And you know, I would just hope that like things would just get better, and it just didn't. And I was young, and things were just happening so fast. And I think we desperately needed maybe like a break, you know, or something to reconnect with each other as a band. And that didn't happen. We were just so, you know, pushing forward, and we had to, you know, we were on tour. And, but yeah, I think that would have, you know, I don't know. I mean, it's looking back, you know, I regret some of my behavior, but at the same time, you know, we're human beings, and the things that Rob did is just unexcusable to me. Like, I don't want to say it.
I will second that.
I just will not, you know, like we're on this planet for only X amount of days and years, right? And why subject ourselves to such behavior? Somebody that's supposed to be like your family. And I just felt like I was just stabbed in the back, you know? And then we had a phone call, and I just wanted to talk to him about the situation. And he said, look, if you don't like it, quit the band. I'm like, oh, well, is that what you want? And he said, fuck you, quit. And he hung up. And I was like, holy shit. I looked at Jay. And I was like, looks like it's done. And then well, that's it. Yeah. After, you know, so many years, you know, it's like.
So shocking. It was so shocking.
Yeah.
I still don't understand what the fuck happened. I was like,
Well, we were very young, and we were, you know, as Ivan says, we were always pushing forward no matter what, you know, always, every second we were pushing forward. Everything was for the band. There was no energy for you know, sharing feelings.
Exactly. Yeah.
There was no den mother or marriage counselor. You know, there's nothing like this.
A marriage counselor might have been a good one, huh?
Yeah. I mean, I've seen this play out in, you know, a lot of bands, especially when they go on tour and they're forced to be together 24 hours a day. And, you know, everybody's being a hard ass, you know, this happens all the time. You know, yeah, I wish we'd have been, we would have had a little more presence than we did.
Yeah. And
I would say.
I wish there was more communication. I didn't really even know about it till the next day. And I was just like, what the fuck? I mean, Ivan's like my little brother, you know, never really bounced back from that, honestly.
But you know, there's one person, you know, I have to give great thanks to, and that's Greg Skorka. He was there from the very beginning. He was there from the beginning, like almost like on the 45. I was walking down Fifth Avenue in Brooklyn, and Jay just Greg Skorka was walking down, and I was like, hey, check it out. You know, there's Slaughter the Grey, Pig Heaven. I showed it to him. He's like, this is cool. And from then on, we started hanging out. And I was, I don't know how old I was, but I introduced him to you guys, and we started, he was like around all the time from that day all the way till after I left the band. I think he was on the tour for a little bit longer. And
a little bit more, yeah.
So,
people who are fans of the band will have seen Greg because he's the one wearing the Gene Simmons makeup on the cover of the God of Thunder 12.
Yeah.
And that's Greg Skorka.
And he and the band's are first both roadie. In the Thundercast video, right? The Thundercast video. And along with
Damien.
Yeah, Damien and then Ryan from Streets of Power, right? Remember him?
Yeah.
He was one of the monsters. Rest in peace, Ryan. I heard he passed away.
Wow. I wouldn't certainly beat yourself up or have any, you know, ill feelings towards the past, considering you're young, burnt out, pushing forward, and like I said, even from an outsider looking in, you guys were just non-stop.
That's true.
It really was.
That's right.
Take it from the inside. That is absolutely true.
Yeah, we just kept touring.
And of course, you know, the elephant, invisible elephant in the room, clearly one of you is missing from this conversation, right? I actually did ask Rob to be part of this conversation, and he respectfully declined. What is your relationship with him these days? Do you guys speak to him at all, or?
I haven't talked to that guy this century. Seriously.
It's his choice.
I mean, he called me up whenever that was, and he's like, I want to break up the band, and I was my response was just like, good, finally, Jesus Christ, what a relief, you know?
Yeah.
And I literally have not talked to him since then. I saw him on the street one time. He saw me coming, and he ran and ducked into a doorway.
Are you serious?
I'm totally serious. I was walking down Larchmont in Los Angeles. He was walking down the street with Sherry, and they saw me, and they panicked, and they like jumped into Starbucks. Seriously, the weirdest thing. Yeah, I don't know.
I saw him at the Joey Ramone Memorial. Was it Joey Ramone or Didi Ramone? One of those guys. We talked, shook hands, and you know, like to me, I just that's so far in the past. I just, you know, so proud of the work we did as a band that I just let it all go. And I just told him, you know, it's all good, man. It's all good.
That's
life's
great.
Too short to hold on to that luggage. I held on to it. Believe me, it took me maybe 10 years to get through that. You know, even still, it's still in there. Like, I'm sure you guys feel that like motherfucker. You know, but then you just like, okay, that was good. I feel better now. You just got it. Every now and then you got to go, motherfucker. And I'm like, okay, I'm good now. Right? You gotta have an outlet. Good thing I'm a drummer, right? I can beat the shit out of the skins and I feel better. You know, I had, you know what? No, seriously, we need to know therapy is good. You gotta have an out. You gotta have, just get it all out. There's a lot of shit there, man. It's sitting in our soul that,
I mean, you actually had a civil conversation with him. Me and Jay haven't even had that.
You haven't even had talk at all, huh?
It's just not part of my life at all.
Still more communication with him than we have.
Wow. Yeah. I just look at it like he's just another human being that, I mean, can you imagine how much shit he's holding on to? Like we had to deal with what we dealt with, but with all the bridges he burned along the way, imagine his soul when he has to go to sleep. No, I mean, you gotta have compassion for someone like that too, you know, because you know, he's still doing it out there. He's still big time, you know, doing the Monsters movie and like he just keeps pushing forward. Like talking about pushing forward. He's stepping on all these souls and he doesn't realize it. I'm sure he's like, oh shit, I wanted to say sorry, but he's gone now. You know, I'm sure he has feelings that if he could, he'd probably talk to us and just say, I'm sorry and all that shit. But I don't know. He's probably just so built up with so many layers of shields around his soul that he can't just open up. I don't know. You know, I mean, we're all human beings, and but anyway, you have any more questions? I'll shut the hell up.
Yeah. I'm just letting you vent, letting you go. I mean, naturally.
Thank you. I kind of needed that.
It's a good interview tactic. Just let him talk.
Yeah. But naturally,
you're like the Terry Gross of metal. Let him talk. Let him talk.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Ivan speaks up finally.
Yeah. Well, no. Honestly, I'm excited that you're all talking and that you're all here and willing to talk about it and stuff like that. Because I think it's a perspective and voice that the metal world hasn't heard, really. You know what I mean? Because Rob, as you mentioned, Rob Zombie's still out there going through it, tenacious, you know, year after year doing new things. But like, I'm here to talk to you guys. And you know, because whatever misconceptions are out there, each one of you have gone and done amazing things since this record that we're celebrating now. You know, I know Sean has been in several bands since, released a great book about our time in White Zombie, found success in being a fine artist. Ivan, you know, you've been in Healer and a bunch of guest spots as a drummer. You've never stopped drumming, still have those chops. I still see the YouTube videos out there coming out, you know. Built your own recording studio, producing records. Jay, always traveling the world. I see on your Instagram, you're all over.
Before the pandemic, yeah.
Yeah, and now you don't even live in America anymore. And
that's true.
You know, producing bands, working on soundtracks and albums. To say the least, you guys have done a lot in the 30 years since this record came out. To put it simply, I did want to ask, like, where are you now? You know, like, what are you excited about and working on right now?
I've got a few things. I'm gonna have a photo opening here in New Orleans. I live in New Orleans, here in New Orleans in the beginning of May, and then I got invited to be in a show in Mallorca, Spain, at the end of May. And I've got a new design line of my, I do like graphic design, hand drawings for like wallpaper and fabrics and stuff. And there's a place here that sells my stuff anyway. They're gonna have an opening for that too. So I've got a big month in May. That's just keeping busy with my photography and design.
I have a couple bands going on right now, actually. One of them is called Big News, and we just released an album on, it's just hard for me to, I just looked at my some notes today, and I was like, oh wow, it was February 14th. We released the record when the pandemic dropped, right on 2020. I have another band going on right now called Boundless Joy. And this is like a heavy metal thing as well. Both bands are just pushing through the like classic heavy metal sound. And but right now with Boundless Joy, we just finished almost done mixing our initial single that's going to be released here probably the next few weeks. And so when this posts, you guys should be able to check it out. We just did a photo shoot last week, and I'm really proud of these projects. They're kind of cool, you know. I just love drumming and being a part of bands that that all get along and get excited about.
What's that like?
I know. Hey, man. It's like the way we were together when before shit got crazy. You know, when we used to be a gang going to concerts together. Remember those days?
Yeah, I do. It was fun.
I know. It's you know, nothing stays the same. Like you might have it wonderful today, and then next week, you know, oh shit, he's a heroin addict. What happened? Oh no. You know, since White Zombie, I've been through so many bands that had so many problems. It's like marriages. Look at how marriages fail. I mean, how many marriages really stay together that for a long time? And that's two people. Being in a band, you're with four people. It's like...
I gotta say, you just mentioned drugs. That's one thing. Nobody in our band ever...
I know. We got so lucky with that, right?
Don't do drugs, kids.
Maybe that was the problem.
At least...
That was the problem.
Anyway, Jay... I was just gonna say,
contrary to everybody's expectations of us, like, yeah, we were not a party band at all.
Yeah, no. Drink a lot of coffee.
Yeah. As to what Ivan was saying, it's really true. You know, it's like whenever you hear like a behind the music story about a band, it always starts with like, you know, they're like thick as thieves and they like play a show together or they go see a band together. And the next morning they all go and get breakfast together and talk about what they saw and what they want to do based on it. And it was certainly true for us too. And then at the end of those stories, it's always like, and then we were in four separate tour buses and we never talked and we never saw each other except for when we were on stage. How many times have you guys heard that story?
Yeah, it's so sad.
And it's like such a cliche, but it happened to us too, you know?
we talked about that then. I remember us actually specifically having a conversation about the rock star singer. We didn't have that, you know, at least... you know, our band doesn't have that frontman issue. We were talking about, I think we were talking about Guns N' Roses with how Axl Rose is such a problem with the band. But with White Zombie, we're all cool, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, that's the way it always is.
What happened? I don't know. Yep. Yeah, yeah. No.
Well, Jay, I wanted to ask, like, what are you up to? What are you...
Oh, I'm strictly in baby land. I mean, if you want to talk about like how to effectively clean a high chair or how to puree food, I'm your man right now. But other than that, I got nothing.
Oh, that just blows me away. The guy that
it sounds like you're sitting on some demos, actually, though.
We are sitting on some demos. We've been talking about putting them out, you know, perhaps as part of an anniversary package. I don't know. There's no concrete plans yet. We'll let you know when there is. But they sound really good. I was really surprised when I heard them again. We did transfers a couple of years ago, like really good transfers from the original master, and they sound really, really good. They're interesting too. Do you know who Jim Thirlwell is? Mm-hmm. Okay, so Fetus. You know, probably like your people who listen to you who are more into industrial music will know who that is. He produced it, which is kind of interesting. And you'd think that it would be all, because it's him, it would be like all like samples and loops and stuff. It's not. It's basically like a band. You know, there are a few sound effects and some of the, you know, early sampling is in it, but it's a band for sure. So it's kind of interesting because I don't think I've ever heard anything he's done where it's like musicians playing instruments, you know, as much.
Yeah.
You know,
are you still playing these days, even just for fun?
A little bit, you know. I'm not in any hurry to, like, you know,
go on tour,
get back in a van. Jesus Christ. I mean, is anybody playing right now? Mm-hmm. No, I'm trying to think of when was the last time that I actually saw somebody play music, and it's coming up on like 2 years. I mean, I don't know how it is for you guys, but
well, in the States, it's people are playing. There's plenty of shows.
Oh yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, with COVID, of course. Yeah. I just saw Takumi, our guitar bass tech, and Andy O, our old drum tech, and
oh wow,
and all these people on tour with Tool. They passed through New Orleans recently, and cool. You know, they wanted to, like, Maynard came out and said hi and offered me a, you know, ticket or whatever, a pass, but they didn't have an area that wasn't going to be a crowded, sold out arena area, and I'm just not comfortable being indoors yet with a lot of people.
Yeah.
Well, I could tell you, you know, as a growing drummer myself of, you know, back in the early 90s and whatnot, Sexorcisto was one of those records that I would run home after school to play along to every single day.
Oh, man.
Yeah!
And I can't, awesome. That's...
And I can't tell you how many of my friends adored, you know, like your songs and Jay's guitar tone. And, like, we still to this day, me and my friends talk about your records, so... Sean, Jay, Ivan, thank you so much for your time, your insight, your inspiration that you gave to metalheads around the world who are still picking up instruments today. Happy 30th of Sexorcisto, a tremendous achievement and accolade that I hope that you cherish as much as we do.
Thanks, Frank.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So freaky.
Great catching up with you guys.
Yeah.
Yeah, you too, man.
Yeah. Really. Yeah.
Good to see you.
Really cool. Yeah.
Thank you for bringing us together.